In The Descendants volgen we een dysfunctionele familie op Hawaii. Regisseur Alexander Payne en de jonge actrice Shailene Woodley over eerlijk en vrij acteren.
Scotty! Hey, Scotty! Scotty! Hey! Listen. Don't pay any attention to that guy. That guy's a dope.
I hate him.
Yeah, I know. Hey, let's do something crazy. All right, let's drive over to the airport, we'll hop over to the Big Island, and we'll surprise your sister. What do you say?
Right now?
Yeah, it'll be fun. She's not expecting us, and we can bring her home. I think she should be here with us, don't you? Don't you miss her? I miss her.
Yeah. I mean, I'm out of school. She should be, too.
There you go. Okay. Let's go. Come on.
How to find and tell the truth in film? I'm sorry to give a boring response, but it's just what feels right.
Uh-huh.
You know, and like I said before about making a film, it's much more discovery than execution. So it's a constantly instinctive, this is what it is, it's a constantly instinctive process of discovery. From the moment you write the screenplay, scene one, you're not saying, at least I'll speak for myself, I'm not saying this is how the world is, this is truth. It's all a question. What is a film? What is life? What if people were in this circumstance? What would happen?
So
it's more an act of curiosity on my part than a statement or expression of something.
I don't like eggs.
Why didn't you tell me before I made them?
I thought they were for you.
Good morning. How you feeling? Hungover? Why am I not surprised? I thought you were supposed to be getting your act together.
I have gotten my act together. I was just drinking. I've been doing really well, actually. Nobody ever seems to notice that. Grades are better. I was in that stupid play that you guys didn't even bother to see. Do you even remember the name of it? That's what I thought.
When you started filming The Descendants, did you have a clear image of what grief needed to look like in this film? You didn't?
No. I'm trying to think. I didn't think about it like that. Well, you know, the thing is about people, and then this has to do with directing actors. As long as the actors are doing an authentic job or feeling things authentically, I don't need it to look like anything. You know, now we have, what, 7 billion people on Earth. Well, that's 7 billion different versions of grief.
Mm-hmm.
Or how you cry, or how you laugh, or how you respond to things. So just as long as I felt the actors were truly present, then that's okay with me. You know, when I make a film, not just in that respect, but every respect, I have a screenplay, so I know how it looks like in black and white on paper, but then how it's supposed to look like in flesh and blood with people,
yeah.
That's what I'm interested in seeing. You know, I don't have a predetermined idea. I want to just put them in that circumstance, and I'm curious to see what happens and have a camera running.
And so give your actors a lot of freedom of expressing their own way of their emotions of the characters.
Yeah, they've been chosen by me, so I'm interested in their versions of things.
You really don't have a clue, do you? Dad, Mom was cheating on you. That is what we fought about. When I was home at Christmas, I caught her with a guy. It made me sick to see her near you. I went back to school thinking that that was it, that I was just done with her. I was gonna call and tell you everything, and then the accident happened, and I was waiting until she woke up, I guess. You didn't even suspect, right? Right? You disgusted me, too. You're always so busy.
Caught her with a guy. What does that mean?
was on my way to swim in the Black Point pool with Brandy, and suddenly I see Mom and some douchebag walking into a house. His house, I guess.
Just some guy. It could be anybody.
And he had his hand on her ass. It was gross.
You're playing George Clooney's daughter, so I guess you have been tested against him before you started?
Yeah, I was super excited to meet George Clooney, not because he was a famous actor, or a famous star, but because he's a good actor. And to be able to be in a scene with him where he was available and professional and he was giving you so much to work off of.
That was the audition, right?
Oh.
You're talking about.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did you say audition?
Yeah, I meant.
I'm sorry.
You still have to land the role first.
Yeah, I didn't audition with George Clooney.
You didn't?
No. I auditioned just for Alexander, opposite a casting director.
But is it so important that you, as a daughter of Clooney, get along somehow? You were never tested against each other?
Nope, never. I mean, George had the role before I was attached. George was attached before anyone else. And I guess Alexander just saw that we would be a good match. I don't know. That's the beauty of a director, right?
It is a very difficult role because you have to be, it's emotionally, deeply emotional, but also sort of lighthearted and comical. How did you find the right balance?
I didn't really think about it, to be honest. It was so brilliantly written by Alexander Payne that for me, there wasn't any acting to be done or any finding this or doing that. It was just being in the moment and listening to what the other character had to say and delivering your lines with the emotion that was evoked from the other characters.
Who is he?
I thought that the director must have said something about that he wanted to see the emotion in the way you guys moved. Is that true?
No, Alexander has a very strong point of view for his films, which is what makes him brilliant, right? Because he's not a chaotic director. He's very confident in what he wants. But within his rules and restrictions, we were basically given the freedom to do whatever we wanted. So we would do what we wanted. And if it didn't work, he would come up to us and say, oh, maybe adjust this here, do this different. For the most part, it was like being a little kid in a candy store.
But he didn't ask you have to slouch your shoulders or whatever?
Oh, never. I mean, as far as physical, Alexander never commented on it because Alexander Payne's whole directing style is capturing humanity as we humans are. So he would never say, Shay, put your arm like this, because naturally I would never put my arm like this. So he was really keen on finding people who were able to play the characters comfortably within themselves.
So the scene in the swimming pool, which is a very good, great scene, the moment you hear that your mother's gonna die soon. Was that scripted or did you think of it yourself?
It was scripted that she goes underwater and distorts her face. And the way I interpreted that was I go underwater and lose my shit, so to say. To go underwater and it's a safe zone, right? No one can hear you, no one can see you.
So, except for the camera, of course.
Except for the camera. But as the character, she got to be vulnerable without having to be vulnerable in front of anyone. So to go underwater and to cry and to scream and to freak out was, for me, one of the most the biggest emotional release I've ever had in my life. Get out of my underwear, you freak!
No, okay, no.
Don't
back inside, put on a swimsuit.
Why?
Now!
A real good job you're doing.
That's part of why I brought you here. You have to help me with her. I don't know what to do with her.
Maybe if you spent more time with her, she wouldn't act like such a complete spaz.
This is your big leap from television to cinema? Or was it a big leap?
Yeah, it's my first feature film.
But was it a big leap?
No, it wasn't. It wasn't really hard. It wasn't a weird transition. It wasn't a hard transition. Because every set is similar, just in the sense of, like, here's the camera, the logistics of the sets. But what was different was the freedom. On a TV show, you're told, put your hands here, do this, don't do that, say your lines, and done. On this movie, like I said, it was like I was on a playground. I could go on the swings or go down the slide or do whatever I wanted because Alexander gave us the freedom to portray these characters how he wanted them within his own vision.
Thank you.
In Rotterdam kun je 100 meter achter de toekomst aanrijden met het kunstenaarsduo A-Team.
I'm setting up the project 100 meters behind the future. And right now what I'm setting up here is the program which captures a video from the front, delays it by a certain amount of time, the 10 seconds delay, that is the difference between the two cars, and the transmission from one car to the other. Everyone's ready?
Let's go.
Let's go. Everyone's here?
Well, this is a scripted action. The first car will be the camera car. And we have like a lady, it's called the appearance, jumping in front of that car. And she has like 3 seconds to make an impression. And then afterwards, the viewer's car is passing by. And while they are passing by the same spot, they will hopefully see on their screen the lady jumping in front of the windshield, which is not their windshield, but they should not know whose windshield it is. It should be their view, basically. When I sat there and experienced it, it was always kind of like a mind-boggling moment where I thought, like, where is she coming from and why is it? And every time it happens, to kind of like reconstruct, am I behind the future or am I in front of it? When did it happen? Do I trust the image on the screen or the reality? Because like they should actually scream, stop! They should not sit there and just watch the screen because someone is in front of them, so to say. So if they don't scream stop, then they're probably still more tuned to the reality than to the screen.
Weet je wie ik gisteren tegenkwam, Moni?
Nee.
Sophie.
Oh.
Sophie is een trut. Jimmy is heel aardig van je, hoor. Je hoeft het gesprek niet op gang te brengen.
Ik wou dat we getrouwd waren.
Waar heb je het over? Is dit weer zo'n moment dat je spijt hebt van je hele leven?
Ja. Als we getrouwd waren, kon ik tenminste van je scheiden. Een advocaat, lekker hard.
Ik kom net uit de film Nick. Wat vond u van de film?
Prachtige film.
Ja, ik vond het fantastisch. Ik kom net eruit lopen, dus het is nog een beetje vers. Maar ik vond het een hele bijzondere film.
Ja, in het begin niet zo. Ik zat er eigenlijk aan het einde net in. En ik dacht van, oh ja, nu gaat het net leuk worden. En toen was hij afgelopen. Dus, ja.
Voor een Nederlandse film vond ik het echt een goede, interessante film.
Normaal ga ik nooit naar dit soort films. Normaal ga ik altijd naar de actiefilms, maar ik vond het wel leuk.
Ja, we moesten er even inkomen. En van tevoren hadden we wel iets van road movie meets karakterstudie. Dus wij dachten, nou, daar gaan we voor.
Ja, het gaat eigenlijk over een hele vervelende jongen. Die eigenlijk heel onaardig is tegen iedereen. En dan wordt hij een soort van verliefderig. Ja, het wordt niet helemaal uitgesproken op een meisje op zijn werk. En ze gaan samen op reis. En dan gaat het over die reis.
Je wist niet zeker waarover het ging, dus je moet zelf een beetje het verhaal verzinnen.
Ja, en heel kort gaat hij naar Kroatië om truffels te zoeken.
Het deed mij dus een beetje denken, ja, ik weet het misschien, mag ik het helemaal niet zeggen, maar aan Murakami, die schrijver, die heeft Kafka aan het strand, dat boek van hem. En op het einde gaat ook zo'n jongen helemaal in zo'n hutje zitten, midden in de bossen. En
de mensheid is verlaten en God is de natuur. Zoiets. En de mens vindt zo God terug.
Ik vond het een mooie film.
Iedereen moet erheen.